Genius Kids. Cultivating love for learning.
Lesson 5. The impact of British rule on rural India. Knowledge acquisition. The East India Company established its hegemony Bengal after the Battle of Plassey in 1757. Unlike the Mughal rulers, they were only interested in exploiting Indian resources for the benefit of British industrialists and traders. The conquest and exploitation of India was an important means of capitalist development in Britain. Money siphoned off from India strengthened Britain's economy and elevated its whole social and political system. The exploitation of the Indian market and of Indian raw materials supported England's industrial expansion in the 19th century. Rural Indian economy before the British. When the British came to India, villages were self-sufficient units. They needed very little from the outside world except items like salt and clothes. Each village was a well-knit society comprising professions suited to the village economy. While peasants tilled the land, many supporting occupations like carpenter, potter, weaver, priest, etc. performed all the services needed by the village. The farmer owned the land he cultivated and he could not be evicted. He paid a small part of his produce to the king. In case of crop failure due to natural calamities, such as floods, droughts, the king reduced the land revenue and sometimes totally wrote it off. The coming of the British changed the scenario. Advent of British rule. The Battle of Plassey marked the decline of India's rural economy. After acquiring political authority in Bengal, the company annexed the monopoly over commerce in Bengal. After the Battle of Buxar, 1764, got the right to collect revenue of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. For some time, the company did not disturb the existing structure of revenue collection. But soon, the corrupt officials of the company started harassing the peasants. The company needed money for strengthening its administration and expanding its dominion. To extract more income from land revenue, Robert Clive, the governor of Bengal, introduced the dual system of government. Taking Clive's work forward, Warren Hastings, the first Governor General of India, abolished the dual system and formed a Board of Revenue to supervise the whole machinery of revenue collection. Changes under British rule. With the expansion of British territories, the amount of revenue collection also increased, and land revenue became the main source of income for the British. This forced the company to formulate such policies that guaranteed maximum revenue collection regularly. To smoother the revenue collection mechanism, the company brought about some changes. The three presidencies, Bengal, Bombay, and Madras, adopted different systems of fixing responsibility for the payment of land taxes. In Bengal, the local zamindars were asked to collect fixed amount of taxes in return for ownership of large estates. Under this arrangement, the British did not share in the gains of any potential improvements in agricultural productivity. In Madras and Bombay Presidency, peasant paid annual taxes directly to the government. The tax rate could be adjusted at fixed intervals. So in this case, the British could reap the benefits of agricultural expansion. India was forced to produce raw materials, including raw cotton, for export to England at throwaway prices and buy manufactured goods, including cloth, from England at high prices. This placed India at a great disadvantage, since it was forced into a situation where it lost on both sides. As a result, the cottage industries that produced textiles in India were ruined. British agrarian policies. the British policies were mainly focused on getting maximum income from land without caring the interest of India peasants. The villagers were thus fleeced by the company as well as by its officials. From 1767 to 1793, Warren Hastings introduced the system of auctioning the land in 1773. Before this, land revenue settlements were made annually. Now, Hastings auctioned the right to collect revenue to the highest bidder for a term of 5 years. The bidding was mainly done by rich merchants who were only interested in collecting. The zamindars were more concerned about extracting money from land than introducing modern inputs in agriculture revenue, and they did not care for the productivity of the land. This increased the misery of the peasants. The system failed as the company's income did not increase at the expected rate. Hence, the old annual settlement system was reinstalled. In 1781, a new plan was adopted for the administration of revenue. The essence of the new plan was to centralize the whole system of revenue collection in Bengal. A new committee of revenue consisting of 4 members assisted by a Diwan was set up. The provincial councils were abolished. The scheme suffered from all the evils and abuses of over-centralization and finally broke down. In 1786, a rational scheme was adopted. Districts were now organized into regular fiscal units, and the collector in each district was made responsible for setting the revenue and collecting it. It continued till the beginning of 1790, when Lord Cornwallis announced the settlement of land revenue for 10 years. This was known as the decennial settlement, to be made permanent if approved by the Court of Directors. This policy of permanent assessment received legal sanction during Cornwallis' rule, and in March 1793, the decennial settlement was declared permanent. To ensure a regular income, the company decided to fix the land revenue of Bengal and Bihar on a permanent basis. This scheme was introduced in 1793 by Lord Cornwallis and came to be known as the permanent settlement. According to it, the revenue to be collected from an area was fixed permanently. The local zamindar was asked to collect the revenue from the peasants. Every year, he had to pay the fixed amount by a certain date. He could keep the surplus amount. But if he could not pay the stipulated amount, he would lose his zamindari rights. Thus, the collector of revenue now became a landlord and his ownership rights became hereditary. This system was extremely advantageous to the company as it ensured them a fixed and regular income without the trouble of collecting it from each peasant. But on the other hand, if the zamindar failed to pay his rent, for example, in times of floods, droughts or due to poor crops, his land was confiscated and sold. The traditional landlords were soon replaced by the new moneyed class who preferred to live in urban areas. Thus, it introduced the concept of absentee landlords. This now class of landlords was loyal to the British. They leased out their lands on high rent to tenants who further subleased the lands. This system increased the rent rate ultimately shouldered by the last tenant, who was the actual cultivator. But it also failed to protect the interest of the ryots. Although the cultivator's position was much better than the permanent settlement system, the rigid revenue collection forced the cultivators to fall into the clutches of moneylenders. However, this system was a marked improvement over the previous system as it recognized the cultivator's right to ownership of the land. But the long-term effects of this system were not very different from those of the permanent settlement. Mahalwari settlement. In 1830s, the Mahalwari system introduced in parts of northwestern provinces, centers provinces and Punjab. Mahal means a group of villages. A system of common ownership of lands prevailed in these mahals, Hence, the system was called Mahalwari system. The Talukdar or the head of the Mahal was responsible for collecting the revenue from the village and handing it over to the British collectors. But instead of protecting the peasants, this system increased the social inequalities and proved economically disastrous. Impact of these policies. British agrarian policies disturbed the economy of the Indian villages. Now, land became a saleable commodity. It created several classes of social parasites like the landlords and labor. This led to peasant indebtedness, and the system of bonded labor became prevalent in Indian rural society. These land revenue settlements impoverished the peasants. The method of cultivation remained backward. The British or the zamindars took no initiative to improve agricultural methods or launch irrigation projects. As the productivity of the land fell, famines became a regular phenomenon. But the company remained insensitive to the travails of the peasants. To pay the high revenue, many landlords shifted from producing food crops to commercial crops such as jute, groundnut, sugarcane, etc. to increase their income. But this did not benefit the peasants. Only a small population benefited by this new trend and became richer. The peasants and artisans were rendered jobless due to penetration of foreign goods and were forced to become laborers. The emergence of the moneylender class increased the indebtedness of poor peasants. Decline of indigenous trade, handicrafts and industries. The colonization of India by the British was the direct cause of the rapid decline in India trade and industry. The main aim of the colonizers was to uphold the British interests even if it crippled the Indian economy. Thus, without considering policies on the country, the British policies proved to be highly detrimental to the Indian handicraft industry. When the British trying to establish their foothold in India, Bengal was a prosperous region. The important articles of export from Bengal were cotton and silk, salt, jute, opium and saltpeter. Even during Aliwardi Khan's time, agriculture and manufacturing industries were rich and flourishing. But this wealth became a curse when the British forced the silk weavers to enter into contracts to supply stipulated quantities of cloth. The weavers were paid prices that were far less than their usual rates. The company did not allow the weavers to work for any other party to ensure a regular supply of cotton goods and raw silk. The ruin of the weavers in Bengal was completed by the unfair competition from manufacturers in England, who were jealous of the popularity of the Indian cotton goods. The industrial capitalists of Britain reduced India to an agricultural colony of British capitalism, supplying cheap raw materials and absorbing its manufactured goods. British import policy changed from importing finished goods from Bengal to importing raw materials at the cheapest possible price and re-exporting finished Manchester cotton goods to Bengal and other parts of India. The situation became worse after the Industrial Revolution in England and was further aggravated by the opening of the Suez Canal, which enabled sea voyage from Britain to India in 25 days instead of 100 days via the Cape of Good Hope route. The British company took calculated steps to destroy the roots of Indian society, the Indian handloom and spinning wheel, thereby destroying the balance of the village economy. Do you know? Dhaka muslin was known for its quality and fine texture and was the craze of the European aristocracy. Cities like Surat, Masulipatnam and Vishakhapatnam were well known for shipbuilding. Ivory goods, woodworks, Kashmiri shawls, carpets and jewelry were other widely sought after Indian goods. Drain of wealth. The systematic policy of transferring the economic resources of India to Britain impoverished the country. The Mughal rulers had imposed heavy taxes, but they had never tried to siphon off the country's wealth. Instead, they spent their earnings in enriching the country by constructing roads, gardens, lakes, cities, places, etc. But the British used all means to acquire more and more wealth. Indian handicrafts were destroyed due to competition from machine-made British goods and faced extinction. Deindustrialization. The British caused tremendous harm to the traditional handicraft industry. Heavy customs duties were imposed on Indian goods. The British officials preferred European goods. While this provided an impetus to the demand for European goods, it contributed to the decline of industries in India. The abundant availability of machine-made goods at British government to offer any protection to indigenous industry also added weight to the decline of Indian industries. Also, with the subjugation of Indian princely states whose rulers were the main patrons of indigenous artists and craftsmen, patronage to the handicraft industry faded away. India was a major exporter for textiles in the early 18th century, but by the mid-19th century it lost its export market and much of its domestic market. While India produced about 25% of world industrial output in 1750, fell to only 2% by 1900, all due to the company's attempt to make India a milch cow of British capitalism by using Indian resources to support the industrialization of England and by giving it a huge captive market. Ruralization. Apart from the above-mentioned effects of British policies, overcrowding in agriculture resulted in excessive land revenue demand, growth of landlordism, rising indebtedness and growing poverty among the peasantry. Indian agriculture began to stagnate, resulting in low productivity per acre, that too when modernization of agriculture was taking place in the rest of world. In the absence of agriculture, education and primary knowledge of development, hardly any modern inputs were used in India for agriculture. Impoverishment of the peasantry. In both the permanent and temporarily settled zamindari areas, the condition of the peasants was pathetic. They were left to the mercies of the zamindars who raised rents to unbearable limits. The condition of the cultivators in the Ryotwari or Mahalwari areas was no better. Whenever a peasant failed to pay land revenue, the government auctioned his land to collect the revenue. To avoid this, the peasant was forced to borrow money from moneylenders who in the turn charged a very high rate of interest and made things worse for the peasant. Rise of new landlordism. British economic policies gave rise of a new class, that is, landlords. The high revenue demands forced the traditional landowners to sell their land. Rich moneylenders and others bought this land, and the number of intermediaries who exploited the tenants grew. A consequence of rise of this class was seen during India's freedom struggle movement. Along with the princes of protected areas, it also supported the foreign rule. This whole process played havoc with the village economy. The village panchayat's introduction of the concept of land as private and hence transferable property converted it into a market commodity. Land lost its dispossessed peasants and rural tenants were demoted to the agricultural labor class. Development of roads and railways. An industrialized England needed good communication and transport facilities. The means of transport were very backward at that time in India. They were limited to the use of horses, camels, and bullock carts. Metal roads, steamships, and above all railways, though initially for their own benefit, the important commercial centers and areas rich in natural resources were connected by road, railway, and canal networks. The Grand Trunk Road was resurrected, and in 1853, the first railway line between Thane and Bombay became operative. Besides serving the British economic interests, The railways also provided quicker means of transport to their armies, which helped the British to tighten their grip over India. Growth of commercial crops. The 19th century witnessed an increase in the cultivation of commercial or cash crops such as indigo, jute, oilseeds, sugarcane, tea, coffee, and cotton. These crops were widely used in the British manufacturing industries and hence the company encouraged their cultivation. The officials of the company forced the peasants to sow cash crops in their fields. In course of time, however, this practice resulted in a decline in the production of food grains and an acute shortage of food supply. Plantations. The investments in India by British entrepreneurs were directed towards plantations which fulfilled the needs of different raw materials for their industries in England. Plantation crops were also exported to other European countries. Indigo was produced in Bengal for use as a dye even in ancient times. But then it was cultivated more for catering to domestic and ritual needs than to serve as commercial commodity. Its cultivation for commercial purpose appears to have begun in the 18th century. Do you know? The uniform of the British police, the hospital staff, the army and the industrial workers was dyed with indigo. This inspired the term blue-collar workers. Indigo cultivation by British merchants had begun in India in the 18th century. Indigo was a blue dye extracted from a tropical plant used to color. The Charter Act of 1833 granted the indigo planters ownership rights in land, and soon its cultivation spread all over Bengal and Bihar. As indigo cultivation spread, its planters started oppressing the peasants. Now, they forced the farmers to grow only indigo. By 1850, indigo formed one of the most important items of export from India. The invention of a synthetic dye dealt a big blow to the indigo industry and it gradually declined. Tea industry developed in Assam, Bengal, South India and the hills of Himachal Pradesh during the mid-18th century. From the time of Lord William Bentinck, the government was keen to grow tea in Assam, thus the Assam Tea Company was established in 1839. The company enjoyed the government's full support, including grant of rent-free land, development of rail and road systems, and other facilities. In fact, the Assam-Bengal Railway and the Chittagong Port were developed exclusive to expedite tea shipments. Jute plantation was another lucrative investment, as jute was required for packing goods. Cinchona was cultivated for the quinine which, extracted from it, was the sole cure for malaria which was hitherto a life-threatening disease. The other important plantation crops were rubber and coffee, both grown mainly in South India. Decline of rural industries led to the rapid increase in the numbers of the unemployed. Do you know? Exploitation of laborers became synonymous with indigo cultivation, a theme very well depicted in the drama Neel Darpan by Deenbandhu Mitra in 1860. During the American Civil War, 1861 to 1865, British textile mills stopped getting cotton from the USA. During this period, cotton cultivation got a tremendous boost in India to meet the raw material demands of British textile mills. The commercial crops were of hardly any advantage to the Indian people. They mainly benefited the Europeans, who made huge profits. Most of the products were sold in foreign markets and the British pocketed the foreign exchange. The only advantage Indians was that many unskilled jobs were created. However, these unskilled laborers had long working hours and were poorly paid. In fact, near slavery conditions prevailed in the plantations. Peasant revolts. The Indigo Movement, 1859 to 62, was a peasant agitation against indigo planters who compelled the cultivators to produce indigo for the world market. Indigo was Almond's entirely export sector. But for political reasons, they were not allowed to hold agricultural land. They were permitted to purchase and hold landed estates under Act 4 of 1837. Before this act, indigo cultivation was carried on under Ryotwari system. In the new indigo estates of the planters, the riots turned into bonded labor. Several economic and non-economic oppressive practices, including torture, were economic practiced by the planters. Indigo production and its export was a booming business in the early part of the 19th century. But it declined in the 1840s and 50s, and as a result, the profit from indigo production became uneconomical for peasants. Also, indigo was not a lucrative crop as it was planted at the same time as food crops, and the soil lost fertility because of indigo. Hence, the peasants refused to sow indigo on their land. But the planters, who had already invested huge capital, were not willing to withdraw their capital so quickly. As a result, they pressurized the indigo-producing ryots to continue its production. The first phase of revolts in eastern India started in the early part of the 19th century under Biswanath Sardar, who looted the Neelkutis, the estates of indigo planters. 2 decades later, the first signs of trouble again emerged when the cultivators of Saran, Tirhut, Munger, Bhagalpur and Purnia refused to grow indigo. Another major revolt against the indigo planters and their zamindars was led by the Wahhabi peasant leader Titu Mir in 24 Parganas of Bengal, 1831, who provided leadership to both Muslim and Hindu lower caste peasantry. The revolt continued through 1862. The revolt ended when the government finally promised to enact laws to protect their interests. The intellectual class of Bengal supported the revolt by organizing a powerful campaign through newspapers, mass meetings, and by giving them support in legal matters. The aims and objectives of these movements differ in nature and degree from region to region. These movements also aimed at the unification of the peasants, development of leadership, ideology, and peasant elite. These revolts never really threatened the supremacy of the British. They were spontaneous reactions to large-scale dispossession and oppression. Their anger and helplessness led to violence that was directed against the immediate source of their misery, indigo planters, zamindars, and moneylenders. Do you know? The term peasant revolt connotes an agrarian uprising aimed at eliminating landlords and, by extension, the foreign system that introduced and sustained landlordism. There were several reasons that led to the agrarian uprisings in India between 1757 and 1857. The most one was the land settlement process, which structured all British policies throughout this period. The revolt of the Pikes in Odisha under Jagbandhu, the commander of the Raja of Khurda, 1817, the rising of the Gujjars under Bijay Singh Talukdar, 1824, in Kamaun and Gadwal, and the revolt of the Gumsur Zamindars in Ganjam district of Ulisa, 1835-37, reflected the general discontent amongst the traditional feudal elite of the period. From 1827 to 1830, there were many uprisings led by zamindars in Vishakhapatnam against the harsh conditions imposed on them for non-payment of revenue. The one in Palconda in 1832 was one of the most serious revolts. The economic exploitation by the British provoked an intense reaction against the Raj in Bengal. The early years of British rule in India were marked by widespread peasant rebellions. Long before the revolt of 1857, peasants of Bengal and Bihar, who were victims of a terrible famine, 1770, rose in revolt against the East India Company, which had been extracting money and crops from them. This was the famous Sanyasi Rebellion. Along with the peasants and the sannyasis and fakirs, there were also village artisans like silk weavers of Bengal, who had been made to slave for the British merchants and the thousands of unemployed soldiers from the disbanded Mughal army. The rebellion was led by Majnu Shah, Bhabani Pathak, Devi Chaudhrani and other figures. The revolt continued till the beginning of the 19th century. It was marked by daring attacks on the East India Company's offices in different parts of Bihar and Bengal, assassination of notorious Indian landlords and moneylenders, as well as of oppressive British traders and army officers. In 1822, the Ramosi Revolt in Satara under Chittur Singh was another movement to oppose heavy land revenue assessment and revenue collection methods. The Ramoses' uprising finally ended when people were given land grants and admitted in the ranks of the hill police. The Gadkari Revolt was organized by Gadkaris, who were hereditary servants of the Marahas. The revolt caused the British much material loss before it was finally subdued. The Chur Rebellion of Bihar and Bengal broke out in 1796 and carried on till 1816. It was widespread and could not be suppressed easily. These revolts did not stop there. Even after a century had passed, similar revolts took place in Punjab in the early 1930s. The major difference between the old and the new revolts was that while the old revolts lacked proper organization, the new ones were organized by the Kisan Sabhas and guided by the Congress and Akali activists. Though the commercialization of agriculture through the introduction of cash crops and the establishment of European plantations for this purpose provided the context for the Indigo Revolt, it was the settlement of property rights that is generally considered as the main cause of the pre-1857 revolts. Keywords: precedency, administrative divisions of British governance in India, Talukdar, village headman, Mahal, group of villages during the British rule, mortgage, convey a property to a creditor as security on a loan, cash crops, crops grown on sale in the market rather than for use by the farmer who grows. Let's revise. Continuous review. The British came to India as traders. They took advantage of the weak political condition in India and established their political authority. Before the British, villages in India were self-sufficient units in which agriculture and handicrafts supported each other. After the Battle of Plassey, the company was granted the Diwani right to collect the revenue of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. Lord Cornwallis introduced permanent settlement in 1793. As the permanent settlement failed to produce desired results, the British tried Ryotwari and Mahalwari systems of revenue collection. The company exploited Indian craftsmen and merchants and forced them to sell their products at low prices, which were then exported to other European countries at high prices. The company encouraged the cultivation of cash crops. The exploitation of natural and human resources of India triggered off many peasant revolts by the various discontented sections of Indian society.
Like, share, and subscribe.